So another mill idea, two bananas, feed them up the right side. So nice and smooth, get all the lumpy bits out. Don't have to get them all out. And then what we're going to do, we're going to add four whole eggs. So per banana, we're going to add two eggs. I'm doing a few of these, so pop these in. And then what we're going to do, beat them up, of course. Then I'm going to heat the pan up so it's nice and hot, using coconut oil. And then pop them in and cook them like little pancakes. So, eggs in there. Heat them up. Put them in a hot pan. Get the oil all over the pan. And all we do, very small amounts. Tiny little pancakes, like so. And don't take long, they take literally a couple of minutes. Just be careful because sometimes they catch. Really, really nice little snack, great for kids because it's just eggs and banana. If I have a snack to get the protein content up, I'll probably have a shake or something like that along with it. So it just makes a really, really nice snack. So stick them in a little box and they're absolutely perfect.
But I made a comment on Facebook to Anth Bales, who many of you know in this region, in this part of England. I said, you know, your waist, everything is in shape. Your chest, your legs, your back is incredible. Why is your waist so big? And I said, I'm not sure, I don't understand why everybody's extremities and body is looking better than ever, but the waist is so big. There's an issue here. So I guess I'm looking at bodybuilders having bald heads and big waistlines nowadays and wondering why. Okay, and again, with all due respect, okay, I think maybe it's having 15 meals a day, maybe it's eating 15,000 calories a day, maybe it's the GH or the insulin, I don't know. Maybe it's all of the above. But all I'm saying, it's not pretty anymore. And not that I want it to be pretty.
I think it's genetic. Yeah.
Maybe it's genetic?
Yeah, listen, my grandfather died at 106. He looked like Joe Brady. He got hit by lightning at 106.
That stage, and make it my own and own the stage. And it took me a number of years to get there. I remember, after I won the 78 Universe, going to the 79 Olympia, going, oh my God, I'm on the Mr. Olympia stage. Next, the very best in the world. I'm not sure if I belong here yet.
Yes.
Yet, in 1980. I'm still messing with Samir's mind, and I knew how good he was. Imagine standing next to this tiny waist, classic line development. How do you stand next to this kind of guy and win? You have to do something else. So we did some things, and Samir finally showed me, took over and took care of business in 83. I saw you.
It's a trial and error.
It is. But finally in 81 at the Olympia, you know, I finally felt I have to go show everyone how it goes according to me. I have to take the information and the knowledge I've gained from Ed Corney and from Arnold and from Dave and from Frank Zane and from Robbie and take it onto the stage and say, here I am, I mean business. I'm all business today and it's a matter of business, but let me show you how it goes. Not arrogant. Not conceited, but just, I humbly, this is my stage and I own it for the next 10 minutes. Let me show you how it goes according to me. And all of a sudden that year, I lost the Olympia. But you know something? That was the best thing that ever happened to me. For 40 years now, I had a job. I had work. I've been traveling and touring and talking about bodybuilding, the thing we all love. And I established a career based upon losing the Olympia. I mean, what better thing can happen in this world? I can't tell you, losing the Olympia.